Osmosis is the fundamental biological process that involves the movement of water molecules across a selectively permeable membrane. This process is driven by differences in solute concentration on the either side of the membrane, leading to the movement of water from an area of low solute concentration to an area of high solute concentration. Osmosis is critical for maintaining cell homeostasis and play a key role in various physiological functions, including nutrient absorption and waste removal. In this experiment, we will explore the principles of osmosis by using dialysis bags as model cells. Dialysis bags are made of semipermeable membrane that allows water molecules to pass through while restricting the movement of large solute molecules such as sucrose. By placing dialysis bags filled with different solutions into the beakers containing various solutions of sucrose solutions, we can observe and measure the direction and extent of water movement due to osmosis. By immersing dialysis bags in these beakers, we will simulate different osmotic environments and observe how the water moves across the membrane in response to varying solute concentrations. This experiment will help us understand the behavior of cells in different osmotic conditions, which is essential for comprehending various biological and physiological processes. First, we have to label 5 beakers for our experiment. We use glass marker for this purpose. I poured about 150 ml of tap water in beaker 1, 3, and 4. In beaker number 2, I poured about 150 ml of 20% sucrose solution. As you remember, sucrose is another word for table sugar. To make 20% sucrose solution, I dissolved sucrose in water so the final solution contains now 20 grams of sucrose for every 100 ml of solution. By analogy, to make 60% sucrose solution, I dissolved sucrose in water so the final solution contains now 60 grams of sucrose for every 100 ml of solution. The key is to dissolve sucrose first and then carefully add water until the total solution reaches desired volume of 100 ml. Now we have to make dialysis bags. To make dialysis bag, we need dialysis tube. The dialysis tube is typically made from semipermeable membrane, often composed of cellulose or similar polymer. This material allows molecules like water, ions, and small solutes to pass through while blocking larger molecules such as proteins or polymers, or in our case, sucrose molecules. In our experiment, we will use sucrose as the solute. As you know, sucrose molecules are much larger than water molecules. Therefore, water molecules will be able to move in and out of the dialysis bag, while sucrose molecules will be unable to pass through it. Cut a piece of dialysis tube into the 13-15 centimeters. Ensure that the length is sufficient to hold our sample with extra room for tying the ends. In our experiment, we will use 10 mL of sample solution in each bag. So, instead of cutting dialysis tube one by one by one, you simply can use this trick by folding the dialysis tube 1, 2, 3, 4 times and cut it at once on one end and on another end. Here we have 5 dialysis tube. 5 dialysis tubes. So here we are, we have 5 dialysis tubes from which we will make dialysis bags. Now we need to submerge all of our bags in tap water at the same time. As you can see on the screen, I have placed them in a beaker. We will need to leave them there for about a minute to soak. This will allow us to open them up and turn them into dialysis bags. After the bags have soaked, we take out one of them. We gently tie a knot at one end of the bag, being careful not to create a hole. Once a knot is secured, we open the other end of the bag by gently rubbing it between 2 fingers. Let me show how I do it. After we soaked our dialysis tubes, we will have to make dialysis bags. For this, you will have to make a knot at one end, like I do. Look. Here is the knot on one side of the bag. For now, here it is.
Do you see it? That's how it should be. Now I think this dialysis tube may be too big. I'm going to trim it a little bit here. And now I will open it. Well, if it doesn't open, maybe you soak a little bit more. And then, you by moving your fingers like this, you open it up.
Once the bag is open, you can add your first sample using a plastic 3 milliliters dropper or by pouring in 10 mL at once from a graduated cylinder. In our case, the sample is tap water. After adding the sample, we will secure the end with a string and hear how I do this.
And now, since our bag is open, we take the sample. First is going to be water. I have a pipette or dropper. A plastic dropper, 3 millimeters is right here. We need to put 10 milliliters. So how many times we're gonna go? Here, once we go, 3 millimeters. Now we're going to put, milliliters, not millimeters, right? Milliliters. Then we put another 3. Well, some of the water, as you could see, is spilled a little bit, but it's not important. Try to be accurate, but not 2. It doesn't have to be. And we have 6, right? 9. And 1 more milliliters there. Okay, and 1 milliliter. So you see, now the trick is to pull out the water. Or not water, to pull out the air of the bag. And you don't want it to be too tight. So with your 2 fingers, you press it like this. And start turning it. Make sure there is no air trapped and the bag should be loose. You see how loose the bag is? That's how it should be loose and without air. So you turn it like this. And then what do? We use a string to tie it. Here's my string. I should have prepared it. But here, quickly cut it. And now we have to make a knot here. Make sure there is no air, right? And the bag is not too tight. So here I made the knot. Look, this is a perfect dialysis bag for our experiment now. And you trim, maybe this is too long, right? You trim the string and here is the perfect bag. Right? And after our first bag is ready, we place it on the paper towel. I don't have paper towel here, but this is a good station here for me. I can put it on the station. You have to put it on a paper towel like this. We're done.
Here are examples of what your dialysis bags with the sample should not look like. What you see on the screen is incorrect. You don't want your bag to be too full or too tight, as it might not leave enough space for osmosis to occur. This bag has air in it, which will also invalidate your experimental data. Air bubbles take up space within the bag, reducing the volume available for the solution. This can lead to inaccurate measurements of the solute and solvent volumes, which are crucial for observing the extent of osmosis. There should be no air in any of the bags. Not even a small bubble. To ensure precise and reliable result, it is important to remove all air from the dialysis bags before sealing them. The presence of air can create additional pressure inside the bag, potentially distorting the osmotic flow of water. This can result in either a slow or faster rate of osmosis, leading to skewed data. Here is how our dialysis bag should look. There is no air inside, no bubble or bubbles. And the bag is loose, not too tight. So we have made our first dialysis bag filled with water. In the next 2 bags, we will add a 10 ml sample of 20% sucrose solution. We will place the bags on a paper towel next to our beakers. In the fourth bag, we will add 60% sucrose solution. And in the last one, we will add tap water. What we eventually want to do is submerge our bags into the beakers and observe whether the bag's mass changes or remains the same. Let's develop a hypothesis. In our first set, if we submerge the dialysis bag filled with tap water into the beaker containing tap water, will the bag mass increase, decrease, or stay the same? Think. Is the solution in the beaker one hypotonic, hypertonic, or isotonic? You are correct. It is isotonic. Therefore, over time, there should be no change in mass of our bag. The mass will remain the same. If we submerge the dialysis bag number 2 filled with 20% sucrose solution into the beaker containing 20% sucrose solution, will the bag mass increase, decrease, or stay the same? Again, think, is the solution in the beaker 2 hypertonic, hypotonic, or isotonic? You're correct. It is isotonic. Therefore, over time, there should be no change in the mass of our bag. The mass will remain the same. If we submerge the dialysis bag number 3 filled with 20% sucrose solution into the beaker number 3 containing tap water, will the bag mass increase, decrease, or stay the same? Again, think, is the solution in the beaker 3 hypotonic, hypotonic, or isotonic? You are correct, it is hypotonic. Therefore, over time, the molecules of water will rush into the bag from the beaker. This will cause increase in bag's mass. If we submerge the dialysis bag number 4 filled with 60% of sucrose solution into the beaker number 4 containing tap water, will the bag's mass increase, decrease, or stay the same? Think again, is the solution in the beaker 4 hypertonic, hypotonic, or isotonic? You are correct, it is hypotonic. Therefore, over the time, the molecules of water will rush into the bag from the beaker. This will cause increase in bag's mass. If we submerge dialysis bag number 5 filled with tap water into the beaker number 5 containing 60% of sucrose solution, will the mass of the bag increase, decrease, or stay the same? Again, think, is the solution in the beaker 4 hypertonic, hypotonic, or isotonic? You are correct, it is hypertonic. Therefore, over the time, the molecules of water will rush out of the bag into the beaker. This will cause decrease in bag's mass. Before we submerge our dialysis bags into the beakers, we have to weigh them one by one using laboratory balances. The mass of our first bag is 10 grams. Record this measurement in the data table. This measurement is quite accurate, as 1 milliliter of water has a mass of approximately 1 gram. If you are conducting this experiment yourself and measure slightly more or less than 10 grams due to pouring more or less of the sample, that's perfectly fine. The exact starting mass is less important. Our main focus is on observing changes in the bag's mass over the time. We will track and record these changes every 5 minutes to examine the differences. Let's measure the mass of bag 2. Here it is. Its mass is 11 grams. According to our measurement, 10 milliliters of 20% sucrose solution has a mass of 11 grams. Let's record this in the data table. Now it is time to measure the mass of bag 3. Here it is. Bag 3 also has a mass of 11 grams, the same as bag 2. Now let me point out a common mistake. While measuring, I found myself trying to interpret the results. This approach is not ideal. At this stage, we should focus solely on the accurately recording the data, acting as objective observers. All interpretations and analysis should be saved for the end of the experiment to avoid bias. It is essential to conduct experiment without drawing conclusions until we have all the data. Let's record our data, 11 grams. Next, we will measure and record the mass of bag 4 and 5. Bag 4 is 13 grams. Bag 5 is 10 grams. Now we need to simultaneously submerge all the bags into their respective beakers and leave them there for 5 minutes. Here is the side and top views of our experimental setup. Note that each bag should be fully covered by the solution in the beaker. After 5 minutes, carefully remove the bags and place them back to their original spots, next to their corresponding beakers. Repeat the same process by measuring the mass of each bag and recording the results in the data table. And here is our data. Bag 1 is 10 grams. Bag 2 is 11 grams. Bag 3 is 11.5. Bag 4 is 14 grams. And bag 5 is 9 grams. Now, once again, submerge all the bags simultaneously into the beaker and leave them there for another 5 minutes. After the 5 minutes, simultaneously remove all the bags from the beakers. Place each bag next to corresponding beaker and then, one by one, measure their mass using the laboratory balances. Results we record in our data table. Here it is. For bag 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Once again, submerge all the bags simultaneously into their respective beakers and leave them there for another 5 minutes. Afterwards, remove the bags simultaneously and record the new set of data. Here we go, for bag 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Now we will repeat each step once more. And again. And again. Now let's calculate the total mass loss or gain. This is straightforward. Simply subtract the initial mass from the final mass for each bag. Here is what we found. Bag 1 and bag 2 show no change in mass as they were submerged in an isotonic solution. Bag 3 gained 3 grams and bag 4 gained 6.5 grams, which aligns with our earlier predictions since these bags were in hypotonic solution. Finally, bag 5 lost 4 grams as it was submerged in a hypertonic solution. Now, using the data table, create a line graph that plot the data for each bag over time. Don't forget to start by writing the title of the graph. When creating the graph, remember to place mass on the y-axis, vertical axis, and time on the x-axis, horizontal axis. The x-axis represents independent variable, time, while the y-axis represents the dependent variable, mass. Once you have completed the graph, ensure that you answer all the questions in the lab manual. Good luck!